that every structural engineer or designer should follow for the earthquake resistant design of the structures. There is a CSST rule, that is configuration, stiffness, strength and ductility. These four mantras or these four golden words always should remember or always should be considered by the structural designer. That is, building should have a good seismic structural configuration. Building should have a good lateral stiffness. Third, building should have a good lateral strength. And fourth, building should have a good ductility. Number one, we will study about the seismic structural configuration. In seismic structural configuration, number one point is geometry, shape and size of the building. This structure should have ideal geometry, structure should have an ideal shape, and the size of the building should always be considered as an important parameter for determining the earthquake forces. Second is location and size of structural elements. Third is location and size of significant non-structural elements. When we study about the seismic structural configuration, the structure will be simple configuration, that is rectangular plans and straight elevation perform well during earthquakes. What happens is that sometimes we see the structures in which all the columns are in a single line along both the axes. All the beams are in a single line along both the axes. While we also see some structures in which columns are planned in a haphazard way. For example, some column is 4 meter away, second column is 6 meter away, third column is again 8 meter away. So all those columns are not in a single line. So as compared to the building with an ideal configuration or an ideal grid planning performs much better as compared to the building with non-ideal planning. The buildings that are in very architectural buildings or the buildings with very large offsets, those type of buildings may experience large amount of earthquake forces as compared to the buildings with ideal configuration. So here you can see that there are two examples here. Structures with complex configuration, that is setbacks and geometric openings, do not perform well during earthquake. Basically what happens, why they don't perform well during earthquake is that as an inertia force, the building is fixed at the base, earthquake force is applied on the top of the building. So that force has to travel to the ground to maintain the equilibrium. So what happens is that here you can see on the left that the earthquake force is traveling from this point to this point. And here you can see that due to this opening, earthquake force is traveling from this point to this point. So all this configuration role plays a very important role in the seismic stability of the structure. Second is lateral stiffness. Lateral stiffness is the rigidity of an object, the extent to which it resists deformation in response to an applied earthquake forces. Stiffness, what denotes? It is basically, lateral stiffness is basically the resistance of the structure to the earthquake forces. Complementary concept is flexibility. The more flexible an object is, the less stiff it is. Or less flexible an object is, the more stiff it is. So stiffness of structure decreases with the increase in damage of the structure. So here you can see that this is the H and this is the delta. So if delta increases from this point to this point, this stiffness also decreases. Third concept is lateral strength. Lateral strength refers to the maximum resistance that the building offers during its entire history of resistance to relative deformation. It is also somewhat similar to lateral stiffness, that is this graph and this graph is almost same. So with the increase in deformation, the strength also decreases. And then the fourth and the most important point is ductility of the structure. Ductility can be increased by providing ductile reinforcement detailing. So ductility toward lateral deformation refers to the ratio of the maximum deformation and the idealized yield deformation. So here you can see the most important definition of ductility. What exactly is ductility? Delta max, that is the maximum deformation, divided by delta y, that is the idealized yield deformation. So more the building can deform, the more ductile it is. And here you can see that this is the graph for ductility. This is delta y, that is ideal elastic yielding, and this is delta max, that is non-linear maximum deformation. So summary of CSST rule, that is configuration, stiffness, strength and ductility rule. We should have a good seismic configuration. Second, we should have good lateral stiffness. Third, we should have good lateral strength. And fourth, we should have good ductility. So as I'm repeating again and again, keep the simple picture of a structure under earthquake. Building is just like a vertical cantilever projecting out from the surface of the earth. So three principal behavior for earthquake resistant building is that building should be strong enough not to sustain any damage during weak earthquake shaking. This should be stiff enough not to swing too much even during weak earthquakes. Third, They should not collapse during the expected strong earthquake shaking to be sustained by them, even with the significant structural damage. Third is the most important rule. That is, if the maximum earthquake strikes on the structure, it should not be like building can collapse. Building can sustain major damage and the brick wall can sustain major cracks, but the RCC frame or the, you know, like the major steel frame, it should not collapse. And second point, what we are trying to say here is that there should be sufficient stiffness in the building so that it does not swing too much. That is, the deformation should not be too much even during the weaker. So there should be this balance between the ductility and stiffness. So this is, you know, like the most important quote that a structural engineer should keep in his mind while designing structures in his everyday life. If a civil engineer is to acquire fruitful experience in a brief span of time, expose him to the concept of earthquake engine, no matter if he is later not to work in earthquake engine. But actually what happens is that we can easily design structure for dead load and live load. Dead load and live load, almost, you know, like it is a very negligible force as compared to the countries where where the earthquake is a major problem. So you can imagine how much amount of force can travel in the structure and how much sway can occur. He should always take into consideration the damage that the earthquake forces can occur. That is why, you know, like nowadays these non-linear analysis, Poisson analysis are, you know, like given so much significance. So what exactly is the 7 steps of structural design?